Coming up on News Live at 6, a new student center on campus was coming for engineering and computer science students.
This is dangerous. It will make us go blind.
Plus, the House reauthorizes a federal surveillance law, the privacy protections that were left behind.
What the event and the month mean to students. News Live at 6 starts right now.
This is Citrus TV News Live at 6, your campus news leader.
A new campus center is coming to SU. Welcome into News Live at 6. I'm Benjamin Schiller.
And I'm Katie Fongwangsa. Citrus TV reporter Tyler Aldano is outside of the Center for Science and Technology, where the changes are coming to the College of Engineering and Computer Science.
Tyler, what will the new student center offer students?
Now, they're hoping for this to be a place of collaboration for students and honestly, everybody here on campus. This is all made possible by a $2 million donation by the Campos Foundation to build the Campos Student Center. Now, there's a lot of reasons that they're hoping for this, they're wanting for this student center to be built, but one student told me that they're just happy to have another place to work on campus.
Having another place to go on campus, not having to like get myself as far out of my house, I guess, makes it easier to, you know, get the day started.
And all right, and they said that they're hoping to have another place to work, excuse me. Besides this, though, they're also hoping to serve members of the underserved community here. They said in a quote, Syracuse, this space will feature, facilitate club activities and enhance the experience of our diverse student body. More than that, it will be a home on campus that is inviting and welcoming to all. Now, beyond all that, though, there is no word on when exactly this will be open to the public, but we'll follow the situation as it develops. Guys, back to you.
Tyler, thank you. New at 6, in continuation of celebrating Asian American and Pacific Islander Heritage Month, the Filipino Student Association is hosting a banquet tonight at 7. Citrus TV reporter Jackson Breslin is live outside the banquet. Jackson, good evening.
Good evening, Ben and Katie. I'm here outside the Sky Barn on South Campus where the Filipino Student Association is getting ready to host its Asian American and Pacific Islander Heritage Month banquet. Now, the banquet will provide students with the opportunity to play games, see special performances, and even watch an award ceremony as the night goes on. However, that's not all the banquet means. I spoke to Student Association President Bettina Talento about what this event and the month mean to her and how it can help inspire change.
To me, AAPI Heritage Month means visibility, especially in a PWI. I feel like when I first came here, I was so surprised I would be the only Asian in class. It's the first time that I got to see so many Asians in one place and heard their stories and how much they've done for this university and community. It became my inspiration that I can lead change on campus. For other students, I feel like they could do that too and find people to relate with and ultimately like network within the Asian community.
Now, this event is just one of many during AAPI Heritage Month. To learn more about upcoming events, you can visit the SU calendar or the SU events calendar website. Now, reporting live in Syracuse, I'm Jackson Breslin. Katie and Ben, back to you.
Thank you, Jackson. Well, if you're looking to boost your headshot quality, you might have to not look any farther than the iSchool. 2013 alum Keegan Slattery recently purchased an AI tool called BetterShot. The tool offers 120 headshot options ready in 3 hours for $29. Slattery has previously worked for companies like LinkedIn and says he hopes to create an affordable and accessible way for people to enhance their profiles.
And staying on campus, this weekend marks the start of Disability Pride Week, and the university is hosting several interactive events. Students and staff can play video games at the Barn Center with inclusive view, hear from Broadway actress Ali Shoker at Tuesday night's keynote speech, and find career inspiration and translation on Friday at 1:13 Euclid, and jam out in the Shine Student Center Silent Disco on Saturday at 7 p.m. More information can be found on these events on the Syracuse Events calendar. And you know, staying on campus, it's been a gorgeous week for weather. We were essentially in shorts Tuesday and Wednesday. I know our Maura Vaughn may have that information for us.
Yeah, Maura, what can you tell us?
Hey, Ben and Katie. Yeah, so we've been seeing the sun throughout earlier this week, and then we started to see some rain. Luckily, the sun will be coming back, but not today. Today, 55 degrees out and partly cloudy. A little bit of rain earlier in the morning, but they always say you need a little bit of rain to appreciate the sunshine. Looking ahead to later tonight, it's going to be 52 degrees set at 7 p.m., a 30% chance of precipitation. So just be prepared to possibly see some rain. And looking across the region, pretty uniform. We're seeing those higher 50s. I'm even looking at Rome right now. It's 61 degrees. I'm really glad we're back and out of those winter temperatures. Syracuse, 55 degrees. Fulton, 54. Ithaca, 54. Penyan, 52. Looking ahead into later in the week, we'll be seeing some of those similar temperatures and a mix of rain and sun. Ben and Katie, back to you guys.
Maura, thank you. The Northern Lights Plaza in Salina has a new owner. Raymer and Flanagan is purchasing the nearly empty strip mall. It was once home to TJ Maxx, Michael's, Staples, and Christmas tree shops. The only national retailers left are Petco and Party City. Raymer and Flanagan will open a retail store in the plaza in just a few months. They also plan to attract other national retailers to fill the empty space.
The Syracuse City School District is considering an unusual proposal for public schools, providing a school uniform. Advocates like School Board President Tamika Barnett says it could help families living in poverty and improve behavior in the classrooms. Nearly half of the city's children live in poverty, and the district already gives students free food and school supplies. But no other large city school district in upstate New York provides free uniforms.
New details tonight. The Syracuse woman suspected of killing her 5-year-old daughter is expected to testify in court. A doctor has now confirmed Latasha Mott is mentally competent to go before the Onondaga County jury. Latasha Mott is currently charged with manslaughter and concealment of a human corpse. Charges could be upgraded to a murder charge in an upcoming hearing.
The Syracuse Police Department is reporting the death of a 3-year-old involved in an ambulance crash last Friday. The collision on West Onondaga Street was between an SUV and the ambulance. It was on the way to a hospital with the injured infant. After the crash, police say the child was transferred to another ambulance before finally reaching the hospital. SPD says the child died later that day, but they are not investigating the crash as deadly.
Police say a 36-year-old homeless man set a garbage can on fire and damaged the Upstate Medical University building. Edward Champion of Syracuse was caught on camera starting the fire at around 4 in the morning Tuesday. The trash can was next to the center's entrance and caused what police describe as substantial damage to the building. At least 4 Upstate employees were inside when the fire was set. Champion is facing a criminal mischief charge. Tonight, he's in the Justice Center jail.
And CNY SPCA is asking for help finding a man who abandoned 5 kittens overnight. The kittens were left outside the shelter at 3 a.m. this morning in the rain. CNY SPCA Director Troy Waffner says the cats are safe and being looked over medically. They want to find the man to get more information on the cat's medical history.
Well, if you're heading northbound from campus, you can expect some delays in the coming weeks. Construction is starting at I-81 near Cicero Monday morning. This next step is in the massive remake of both I-81 and I-481 and will reduce the lanes by Cicero's South Battle Bay Ridge Road from 2-3 to 2. Essex 9 will north and south will also close at the start of next week. Drivers should follow detour signs to exit 10. All of these closures are expected to last 6 months.
The housing crisis in and around the Salt City continues. 16 of the 19 towns in Onondaga County saw price hikes just from last year. Homes in towns like Marcellus and Pompeii increased over $70,000 in average cost. Towns neighboring campus like DeWitt, Cicero, Clay, Camillus, and Salina all saw increases between 5 and 15%. Those percentages translate to an average price increase of $25,000 to $30,000.
To Clay now, where a former Oswego County Assistant District Attorney is being charged with aggravated driving while intoxicated. Sarah Kickerbocker crossed into the oncoming lane of traffic on Bear Road in early February. Police say she then struck an 18-year-old driver, sending them to the hospital. Kickerbocker resigned from the DA's office just last month, citing several severity of her injuries. According to the police, the former ADA's blood alcohol level was 0.22, more than double the legal limit.
The city of Orwell could soon be required to change a 90-year-old rule. The town has been a dry town, not selling alcohol since the prohibition. But a new state bill could change that. It would end the town's ability to prohibit alcohol. The legislation is up for a state Senate vote to advance. Orwell is one of the 7 upstate New York towns with these types of rules.
Coming up, debate in the House over the way the government can access your communications, even without a warrant.
Plus, the latest on a high-speed crash involving a Super Bowl-winning receiver. What Rishi Rice is saying next.
would never become a superhero. But I learned how to fly, just to come back in a new disguise and be the hero that I've always wanted to be.
Hey, Bobo, do trees tell each other stories?
I'm sorry, I'm afraid I don't know that.
Hey, why don't we go find out? Listen.
Can birds draw pictures?
I don't have an answer for that.
Dad, do stars visit their friends?
Look!
Jason, let's go see your room.
What do you think? We kept it a little spare, so you can decorate it how you like.
Dinner!
No?
Excellent. Suckers. Yeah, I saw you guys out there.
We're the family.
You're watching Citrus TV News Live at 6 with Benjamin Schiller, Katie Fong Vongsa, and Maura Vaughn. Now, your campus news leader continues.
Welcome back into News Live at 6. Start with some national news. The U.S. House passed a bill to reauthorize a federal surveillance tool. The Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, called FISA, lets the government collect communications data from non-Americans outside the U.S. without a warrant.
A group of legislators led by Representative Andy Biggs was looking to amend the bill. They wanted to require the government to get a warrant before surveilling Americans.
Let's do something that the Constitution has had in place for a couple hundred years that has served our nation well and protected American citizens' liberties. Let's make the executive branch go to a separate and equal branch of government, the judicial branch, and get a probable cause warrant to do the search.
The White House and the director of the FBI are against the Biggs Amendment. Representative Michael Turner says the amendment would make Americans less safe and aid foreign terror groups.
This is dangerous, it will make us go blind, and it will absolutely increase their recruitment of people inside the United States, not even American citizens, to do terrorist attacks, recruit for espionage, and to harm Americans, I reserve.
The bill is headed to the Senate without the Biggs Amendment. FISA will expire in 1 week if the Senate does not pass the two-year extension.
Conflict in Israel could escalate soon again. President Biden saying today he expects Iran will attack Israel sooner rather than later. He followed with a warning to Iran not to attack.
We are devoted to the defense of Israel. We will support Israel. We will help defend Israel, and Iran will not succeed. Thank you very much.
The U.S. and several countries in Europe have issued new travel guidelines for Israel. They say Americans should use caution and be aware of the changing security environment.
More debt relief is on the way for college borrowers. The Biden administration announced another round of student loan cancellations today. More than 200,000 borrowers will see their debt canceled.
More borrowers are also becoming eligible as they hit 10 years of payments, though the cancellations are being threatened. Federal lawsuits were filed in Kansas and Missouri against the Biden administration, saying it overstepped its authority.
Let's talk about some state news. Governor Kathy Hochul plans to issue over 400 cannabis licenses this year. The new update will allow provisional licenses to be given outside of regularly scheduled board meetings.
Hochul says the licenses will strengthen the state's equitable cannabis industry. She wants it to ensure small business owners are legally operating. The measure is a part of New York's crackdown on the illegal cannabis market.
More tech investment could be coming to central New York. Senator Chuck Schumer brought representatives from many of Japan's top chip industry suppliers to Washington. Schumer pitched executives from Tokyo Electron, Canon, Fuji Film, Hitachi, and Tok on investing in upstate New York.
They would be joining Micron, GlobalFoundries, Wolfspeed, and IBM that have already announced investment in the area. Schumer wants more companies in the area to be suppliers and promote a semiconductor ecosystem.
The latest now, a Super Bowl winning wide receiver has surrendered to police in Texas. Kansas City Chiefs wideout Rashee Rice was wanted on charges of aggravated assault after a car crash in Dallas last month. Police say Rice and another driver were speeding and caused a crash involving six vehicles.
Rice was released on bond late last night. Rice's lawyer says he is continuing to cooperate with law enforcement. Rice said on Instagram last week that he takes full responsibility for the crash.
An amendment that would enshrine abortion access in Colorado's state constitution will make its way to a ballot in November. Reproductive rights advocates have gotten enough signatures to qualify the amendment to appear on ballots. The group says they are missing less than 100 signatures across three districts before meeting the formal qualifications.
They say Colorado residents are concerned about Arizona's Supreme Court decision upholding a near-total abortion ban. Colorado is one of the 11 states where state organizers are trying to enshrine abortion rights in state constitutions through ballot initiatives.
And coming up on News Live at 6, will these April showers be staying with us the entire week? Stay with us.
I see you mobbing over her. Let's go. Let's mob. Let's crawl. Let's crawl. Let's crawl. Hey, yo, we mobbing. Come on, girl. Let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl.
From the Citrus TV Weather Center, this is SU's most accurate weather forecast.
Welcome back to News Live at 6. Now, you know what they say, April showers bring May flowers, and that's definitely the case for today and tomorrow. Tomorrow, we're going to be waking up to 47 degrees, a little bit of rainy conditions. I'm kind of bummed out. I'm supposed to see the Syracuse Mets with my dad, but that's okay because I'm looking at Sunday, Monday, and I'm seeing that partly sunny, and I'm happy. You never know if the sun's actually going to come out in Syracuse with partly sunny conditions, but I'm hoping and praying for a miracle. 48 degrees on Sunday and Monday, 53. So those temperatures are going to start to come up as the week progresses. Tuesday and Wednesday, though, we're going to be seeing those April showers once again. I don't like that Tuesday humidity I'm already looking at. 56 degrees with morning showers. Going to turn into some cloudy skies. Best to be prepared for some rain all day, though, just in case. So just be prepared on Tuesday to have a raincoat on you. Moving into Wednesday, also 56 degrees and rainy, but just be prepared to have your rain jacket. Speaking of preparation of the rain, I have a little bit of a story. Yesterday morning, my two roommates, Kendall, Claire, and I, we decided to run a 5K for the ROTC. 6:30 in the morning, we were so excited. We wake up all of a sudden, it's absolutely pouring rain. We were like, we can't do this, we can't do this. We ended up going, and I'm pretty proud that we did because that was the most insane conditions. I couldn't see, I couldn't even bring AirPods to listen to music, so I was pretty sad about that. But it always goes to show that being prepared for the rain is so important. And starting after, hopefully after next week, we'll start to see those sunny skies. Once again, you can never tell. Maybe we'll see the snow, who knows? But that's all from me, Ben and Katie, back to you guys.
Maura, thank you. Changes are coming to Disney's theme parks. The entertainment company is cracking down on its disability access service due to misuse. The Florida and California parks will restrict who is eligible to use it.
Before, Disney allowed eligible users to call ahead and then go through an expedited lane. Now Disney says visitors should check the website for updated policies before heading to the parks.
Hey guys, coming up in sports, another Syracuse star guard has declared for the draft. Find out who wants to go pro right after the break. Stay with us.
You're at the top of your game. You're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. Yeah, I saw that coming. That will throw you off track. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
Thank you.
And now, your Citrus TV sports report.
Syracuse men's basketball has already lost six players this offseason, but the seventh could be the most important. Welcome into sports. I'm Andrew Del Piana. SU's leading scorer, Judah Minst, announced on social media last night that he will not return to the Orange next year. The sophomore will enter his name into the 2024 NBA draft in June. In his two seasons on the Hill, Minst averaged over 17 points in 4 assists per game. He also clipped 1,000 career points, the 7th fastest player in program history to accomplish that feat. In the latest ESPN mock draft, Minst is currently projected to go undrafted. And over on the turf, number 7 Syracuse men's lacrosse squares off with North Carolina tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock. SU faces former defensive coordinator Dave Petromala for the first time since his departure. The 3-time national champion went to Chapel Hill after spending the last 2 seasons with the Orange. Even with all the connections between these 2 teams, Syracuse head coach Gary Gate is preparing for the unexpected.
You never know what he's going to do, but he's, you know, has a way of coaching, and you understand that. So you prepare, you know, we prepared our offense to play against his defense, and we certainly played against it the last couple of years in practice. So hopefully, you know, it just comes down to execution.
Should be interesting to see how the Orange attack the Tar Heels. SU offensive coordinator Pat March ejected in the Cornell game 10 days ago, suspended for tomorrow's game as well. Follow at the _ Sam Corcoran for X for live coverage throughout the contest. Now let's go to the women's side, where number 2 Syracuse travels to Clemson tomorrow afternoon. And hey, fans of the Orange may need to start calling Emma Tyrell Butter, because she is on a roll. The midfielder has registered 4 or more points in 7 consecutive games. She continues to make her case for the Tourette Award over SU's 8-game win streak. Tyrell only scored 4 goals through the first 6 contests, but now just needs 7 more to surpass her previous career high of 52 tallies in a single season. Make sure to stay locked into at Rahil Jaswal on X for live updates with opening draw at noon. Let's go to the Diamond, where the Mets and Braves closed out their series yesterday in Atlanta. New York earned an 8-7 win on Monday before the Braves notched a 6-5 victory on Tuesday. So let's get you to the rubber match down in the ATL. Truist Field the site. Let's get into the third inning in DJ Stewart. A moonshot to right field with the Mets already up 5-0. Make it 7-0. New York loving this one early. Let's get to the bottom of the third again with New York already up 7-0. Look out, Brett Beatty. There's a reason they call it the hot corner over there at third base. Get up there, young fella. Denying a base hit away from Ronald Acuna Jr. This game got out of hand so bad, the Braves had to bring a position player into the ninth. Luis Guillerme serving up meatballs with the Mets up 12-4. Tyrone Taylor. Order the charcuterie board. It's a grand salami. The Mets take care of the Braves 16-4 to set a new season high in runs and hits. But let's stay in Georgia where the second round of the Masters tournament is closing up shop soon. Scottie Scheffler has the lead at 7-under, but Bryson DeChambeau, Max Homa not too far behind, just a shot box. Scottie Scheffler going for his second green jacket after winning the event back in 2022. Now, Katie and Ben, there's only one way I know how to hit this back to you guys, so let me tee it up. Four up. Oh, sorry over there, guys. Everything all right? Didn't put a hole in the wall?
Went over. We're good. We're good. Right. Thank you. Well, Andrew, who do you got winning the Masters this year?
I do have Scottie Scheffler. I mean, he's been one of the best players in this last couple of seasons. Won three events out of last six he's played on. Again, like I mentioned, won the event back in 2022. Really disappointed to see Tiger Woods only at the plus one mark, but I really want to see Scottie get that second green jacket, Katie.
No, I'm really looking forward to see how Scottie does because he's been doing so well. Ben, what do you think?
You know, I'm not really a golf fan. I just know Tiger Woods is playing. I've seen some of his highlights on Twitter earlier, so, you know, that's who I'm looking forward into in the Masters. You know, a lot of sports to unpack this weekend. Andrew, thank you a lot. More of Vaughn with your wake-up weather when we return on News Live at 6.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Visit aarp.org/caregiving for information on how to provide even better care for the person who once took care of you.
Welcome back to News Live at 6. Now, when you wake up tomorrow morning, we're going to be seeing those April showers come back again. 40 degrees out, so it's going to warm up throughout the day, though, and end up at 47 degrees. We will be seeing that crazy wind that we saw today. I mean, I almost fell over. It was so windy today. 60-mile-per-hour winds, and I don't even want to talk about it. 83% humidity. My hair is going to be an absolute mess tomorrow. So.
No, me too, Maura. I had my golf class this morning, and it was raining, and it was so gross. That
not
humidity.
Ideal. Yeah, absolutely yeah, not.
Not
my thing.
Good. Not good.
Well, guys, take a listen to this story. A high school student in Baldwinsville is facing a criminal mischief charge after police say he impersonated school officials. Police Chief Michael Ifonchek says a 17-year-old boy sent a fake fax pretending to be the principal resigning.
Well, Ben, well, he also allegedly left voicemails pretending to be school staff and created fake email accounts to get information on another student. So how did he get caught? Well, according to the chief, the teen put his own cell phone number on the cover sheet of the fax that he sent.
That's pretty bold, if you ask me. I would not go that far with my April Fool's Day jokes, but
you know,
wow.
It's kind of crazy. Baldwinsville has been in the news a lot this week. You have this story and Ryan Gosling in New York City spotted with a Baldwinsville football jacket. I mean, there's a lot going on with Baldwinsville the last couple of days.
I know.
They really have the spotlight lately.
They do.
They definitely do. You know, there's a lot to look forward to, and especially last couple, you know, this is a dumb question, but have you ever cheated in school?
Not on air, Ben.
I haven't.
We'll save it for our post show. We'll talk about it in our post show.
No.
You know,
well,
Well, that's Citrus TV News Live at 6 for this Friday.
Don't forget, you can follow us on X and Instagram at Citrus TV News. Now, for the entire Citrus TV News team, I'm Katie Fungwangsa.
And I'm Benjamin Schiller. Have a great night, Syracuse.